Okay, so let's learn about a different way to solve this drawing order problem. And it's using a technique called the Z buffer or depth buffer. Z buffer is probably a safe name for it. And it solves all the problems we mentioned above with the Painter's algorithm. So here's the solution. We just use more memory. So we use extra memory called the Z buffer to keep track of the depth of everything. And here's the interesting part. At a per pixel level, per fragment level, I probably should say. So you can imagine we have our good old-fashioned scene frame buffer, right? And the scene frame buffer holds the pixel values of our scene, so we know what to draw on the raster. Now, next to it, we allocate memory the exact same size called the Z buffer. And the key is that for this any given pixel, if you have a pixel here, there's a corresponding entry in the Z buffer. Okay? So the Z buffer is the same size as the frame buffer and has one entry per pixel. Okay? And this is how it works. One, let's make sure to reset the Z buffer when the frame buffer is cleared. And what we do is we set it to the far plane depth. So basically, it's the furthest away it can be. Okay, set it to the far plane depth. If we're using normalized device coordinates, that's one, right? One's the furthest away. Negative one is the closest away. Remember, one, zero, negative one, right? That's our far plane. That's our near plane. Just remember that. Great. So we reset the buffer. They're all set to far or one. And then two, what we do is, whenever we're drawing a fragment, let's say we're filling a triangle, okay? When drawing a fragment, on the frame buffer, before we plot that on the frame buffer, first, let's check the Z buffer. Okay, at the same coordinate. Remember here, right? You find the coordinate in the frame buffer you want to write to. Oh, well, before I write, I better check the Z buffer. I go over to the Z buffer, check it. If my Z is smaller, it means that I'm in front of what's already there. I can replace it. I draw my fragment. Right? So if my Z is 0.1 and their Z is 1, I'm in front of that, so I can replace that fragment. But I also have to make sure to update the Z buffer with my Z value so that if someone's writing to this fragment but they're behind me, they'll check the Z buffer. Aha, someone's already in front of me at this spot. So it's really simple. When you plot a pixel, you put your depth there. But first you check actually. When you plot a pixel, I'm at depth X. Hey, there's already a pixel there that's closer than I am. I'll just throw away. Okay? So this really works. It works really nicely. And I was just go over this example that I had before, right? here's my example before, it doesn't matter what order you draw them in, because at these spots here, I should use a color, I guess, at these spots here where they're contentious, the Z value of the green is closer here. So if I draw the black first, when the green draws, it'll replace it. If I draw the green first, when the black draws, it'll go, whoa, my Z is behind. I don't replace it. And here, the Z of the black is closer. So when you're drawing the green, if the black is already there, you skip those pixels. When you're drawing the black, even if the green is already there, you override it because the black's in front. So the Z buffer solves this problem. And then the draw order does not matter. Okay. Now, one thing you might have clued into is that, wait a second. If I'm drawing my projected triangle, we've been through this, right? So I'm drawing a projected triangle. I don't have a Z. What do I do? Well, we learned in the 3D unit how we can project the Z in a way that makes sense to maintain that distance information. So if you do that, if you do project your Z to negative 1 to 1, then you'll have your Z values at each vertex. You'll have those at each vertex, and then when you're doing a scan line fill, you interpolate your Z values. Okay. And there's a lot of clever ways to do this, but that's the key. So you can get the Z at each fragment. In fact, you need it for this to work. And you do it by interpolating those values while you're doing your scanline fills or whatever you're doing and whenever you need them. Okay. So the pros here, that you don't need the objects to be sorted. Of course, there are cons, and the cons are, well, we need extra memory. And there's also an extra check and store every pixel. You check your Z against what's there, and you replace it, you update it, if it needs to be for each fragment. So the Z buffer isn't free, but this is now has a lot of hardware support right in the graphics card, okay? And so it's really fast, and it's now this pretty much one of the standard approaches. So you'll come across the Z buffer in any graphics library, any graphics card implementation will have that. Now there's a big problem that's really not obvious, and it's unfortunate. This is where computer science meets math. This is a really nice algorithm. It works, but the implementation adds a limitation that is really not obvious, okay? And the limitation is called Z fighting. I know it sounds like an awesome 1990s fighting game. It's not. Z fighting 95, right? No. It's when the Z buffer fails, and here's how it can fail. With very large scenes, and I want to define large as far minus near being a big space. So you have a big view volume. Or geometry very close together. So either you have a huge range between far and near, or your geometry is really, really packed, which in modern games and movies isn't that unreasonable. Basically, we hit the limits of floating point precision. They get in the way. The floating point precision is not sufficient. To represent the depth difference. I should put the in there. The depth. Okay, so it's not sufficient to represent the depth difference. So you get these visual artifacts. They're called stitching. Because it looks like you've stitched some cloth together in a weird way. Okay, and I'll give a demo of that shortly. But another part of this problem I want to talk about, which is also really not obvious, is that your Z precision, you can't count on it being linear, okay? Linear is probably not the right word. Your Z precision may not be consistent or constant through the scene. Okay, and what I mean by that is, so I have my view frustum. This is only a problem when you're in perspective, I should say. In perspective. So I have my view frustum. I have my far, I have my near, that's great. And it goes through these transformations to give you this kind of flattened, right, cube. And the way that it does that is it divides by Z, okay? We know that, we learned that. And then what happens is when you have things, you know, let's do the mapping here. The mapping is right at near, if it's done right, should go to -1, 0, 1. And if it's done right, the mapping at far should map right to 1. That's great. But what happens is if you divide a number by Z, the impact is much, much bigger on a small number, right? If I have 10 divided by 10 versus 100 divided by 10, the bigger the number gets, the smaller the impact is. And we've seen this already, because in perspective, if things are really far away and you divide by Z, they move just a little bit. When things are close and they move into the Z, they move a lot. And so what happens is, this is my Z direction. As Z goes up, my mapping from my world coordinates to my NDC goes kind of like this. A small change in Z, I go, whoa, it's a big change. Another small change in Z, it's a slightly less change. Okay? And so what happens is you get this kind of compression where when things are close to you, you get a big spread of Z values very nicely. But when they're far away, they compress. So then, to say it another way, we have more precision close to the near plane. Okay, so which is actually kind of nice, right? Because we have lots of things I'm paying attention to. The precision is better when I'm really close up, they can be close together. But you should be aware that, even if we move to double, the fact this compression means that as we get far away, resolution, the precision gets really, really poor. So more precision close to the near plane, and then less precision far away. And if you read about this, people also say it gets worse if you bring the near plane closer to the camera. And that's kind of an indirect way of saying it, because I like to say that a little differently, and that's the compression that happens is dependent on the field of view. And I think that makes a lot more sense, because as I open up my camera, the same with 3D, things, you know, that depth of compression compresses further because Z has less of an effect, okay? So exact compression is dependent on the field of view. Where wider field of view, worse Z fighting. You get more compression really close up. Okay. So I'm going to show a demo of this. I wrote this little program. If you download this and run it, it might work differently on your computer with your graphics card. I have it tuned to my graphics card, but you should be able to play with the numbers. To get the same effect. So here's processing. Up here, I have my near plane set to 1 and my far plane set to 100,000. So I'm going really extreme with my view volume to illustrate this. I have my things drawing at negative 3. What else is important? My default Z distance. I'll explain what's happening here. So go back to my draw here. I have these two planes that I'm drawing, one on top of the other, okay? And the only real difference is I've offset one a little bit so we can see. So let's take a run of this and see what it looks like. There we go. So I have this little cyan thing in front of the red one. Now what I've done though is at this point in time, they're both drawn at the exact same Z. Okay, they're both drawn at the exact same Z. So this one doesn't move anything. So if I draw them at the exact same Z, well, there's no Z fighting because it figured it out. Like, oh yeah, this is drawn after this one, whatever. It's consistent. Now, if I rotate it, that's where things get weird. Look, we have this stitching, the Z fighting. And it gets weird because as I'm rotating it, suddenly I have these interpolated Zs. And then even though they're the exact same Z value, because they're at different spots in the world, we get different Z interpolation slightly based on the floating point precision. This shouldn't happen, right? This is a problem. If I scroll down, you can see that I can hit the space key to add some Z distance between them. What I've done is I've added this tiny, tiny, 1 to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 10 to the minus 5. I'll just add that with a space bar. This tiny distance to this thing, oops, and the Z fighting goes away. Does it? Oh, almost goes away. No, it doesn't. Okay. So first of all, the Z fighting improved, okay, but it didn't go away. So I'm going to add some Z distance, and you can check out down here in the console, 2 to the minus 5. Did it fix it? Oh, a little bit there. Now I'm going to be 4 to the minus 5, so double the Z distance between the planes. Yeah, good. So at this space in front of my camera, we're really good. I can fix the Z fighting by adding this minuscule Z between them, adding a space between them, which is big enough that the floating point precision no longer gets in my way. And it's 4 to the minus 5, okay? But this is where it gets interesting. I'm going to move my object deeper into the scene. And then now, as it's minus 24 into the scene, with the same exact same distance between the planes, I've lost my precision because I'm further down the frustum. And you can see I'm getting this stitching again. I'm going to just try this. There we go. I'm also going to hit scale. So I've scaled by 1,000 or 100 times, 100 times. And you can see it's still bad, and I can make it even further. But I'm going to add some Z distance. There we go. We fixed it. And my Z distance to fix it was 0.02. Wow. So did I fix it? So I needed 0.02 Z, which is actually quite a lot of Z in my coordinate system. It's a big number that it needs to maintain the precision. I'm going to go further away. It comes back. Look at that. How much Z do I need? So my precision goes to crap. 0.1 to fix it. So you see, the further the object gets away in the view. Oh, and I still got some. Come on. 0.3. You know, the further it gets away in my view frustum, the worse you can see. The worse the Z fighting gets because we lose that precision. Okay, look at that. Way back in the view frustum, my Z is minus 6,000, and I'm still getting Z fighting, even though the planes have 0.6 between them, and this two whole Z units between them should take care of that Z fighting. Nope. So now you can actually see the planes are separated if you look closely enough. Anyways. Z fighting's a problem. It's not consistent with distance. You lose the precision differently based on how far it is away from your camera. So that's something you do need to be aware of. How do you fight this? How do you I don't know why that came up there. How do you fight Z buffering? Z fighting. You keep your far minus near distance small if you can. Okay, you keep that small, and you maintain a narrower as you can field of view. If you get to more advanced, you get some people doing multiple stage rendering. If you have really deep scenes, they can do multiple stage and things like that. But yeah, Z fighting's an issue.